you, Sean, and thank you for having me.
The library is now closed, but we will be open tomorrow at 10 a.m. Good night.
Never mind the man behind the curtain.
It's perfect timing. Can everyone hear me all right?
Oh, yes.
Wonderful. I am going to talk to you tonight about regulation without representation. And I began putting this information together starting in 2001, really when I was working for, I have my own law firm, but the state of Wyoming hired me to handle a lawsuit dealing with the roadless litigation. And I put this together, and the regulation without representation is obviously a play on the taxation without representation. And the fact that our forefathers recognized that if they were going to be taxed and have to fund their government, they ought to have some say in what that government is and what that government does. And I think that we fought a revolutionary war over that. We fought for our independence, and we became the United States of America. We became a very unique country at that time. And we have a philosophy, and we have a foundation that really was unique in the world, and definitely an experiment that had never been tried before. And I think that we are now in a situation where we have regulation without representation. And so I'm going to go through and I'm going to give you information about what I mean in terms of regulation without representation, what that means to all of you, what that means to our government. But I'm going to start out with some quotes from Thomas Jefferson, because truly he was a great, great man, and he had a way of saying things that I can only envy. The two enemies of the people are criminals and government. So let us tie the second down with the chains of the Constitution, so that the second will not become the legalized version of the first. And being an ag person and a person who does a lot of ag work as an attorney and growing up on a ranch, I thought what he also said was very precious, very important when he said, when we must wait for Washington to tell us when to sow and when to reap, we shall soon want for bread. I think that those are two good statements that really kind of frame the discussion that we're going to have this evening. I first want to start out with some really good news, which is about the debt. And as you can see, as of 2 days ago, we are at $19.977 trillion. I meant to look today before I came over here, and I didn't have time to do that. But typically when Congress votes to increase that debt limit, these numbers skyrocket very, very, very quickly. But you can just look. In the last month, it's gone from 19...
Whoops.
It has gone from 19.965 trillion up to 19.977. You can look at those other numbers. It was $16.9 trillion just a little over 4 years ago. Those are pretty frightful numbers. The debt right now, as of 2 days ago, was $61,321 per citizen, and it was $165,779 per taxpayer. And I think that there are probably an awful lot of taxpayers in this room, and you can see the difference between the cost per citizen and the cost per taxpayer, and it should be frightening to all of us. It's almost $480 billion in interest per year, and it's in $15,000 in interest per second. The debt has increased almost $9.4 trillion since 2009. I want to continue talking about the debt, because right now the total U.S. debt is $67 trillion. That's $208,000 per citizen and $814,000 per family. You can look at the other numbers and see how dramatically that has grown over the last even 6 months. Total underfunded liabilities in this country are $107 trillion. Yes, that really, truly is $107 trillion. That's $890,000 per taxpayer. What you realize is that we are now to the point where it's actuarially impossible to pay off, and they're either going to have to inflate their way out of it, or they're going to default. Those are all incredibly scary prospects, and it's why we ought to be having a lot more discussion before we do raise the debt ceiling and start looking at some spending reduction. Where does the money go? I refer to this as the California model. As a water and natural resource attorney, I pay an awful lot of attention to water infrastructure and water issues. We've been hearing about the drought in California for many, many years, and it may be a newsflash to a lot of people, but there's a lot of desert in California, especially in Southern California. Yet we've populated those areas pretty extensively. But what has California done? They have essentially the same major water infrastructure today with 40 million people that they had in the 1960s when there was a population of 16 million people. So what does that mean? Their leaders talk about drought. They don't talk about dams. They don't talk about how they are going to actually meet the demands of their citizens. So the leaders of that state, the governors, the legislators, and all of the folks who are active in government in the state are not looking at trying to make sure that they can provide the services that they need to their citizens. California has the nation's largest tax base. But just as California is not spending its money on highways and dams and infrastructure and providing services to its citizens, the federal government is the same way. So what do? They spend their money on salaries, benefits, pensions, and that sort of thing. It is estimated that something between half and 80% of California's state and local spending ultimately goes to employee compensation. You're going to hear me say this quite a few times tonight. That is simply not a business model that can survive, but that's also what we see at the federal level as well. The Air Force, for example, has nearly as many civilian employees as it does guardsmen and reserves combined, demonstrating that they're not focusing on protecting us and on national defense, but it's an employee package, if you will. But I want to go back to fourth grade. I think we need to go back to fourth grade and realize and think about what our form of government is. And again, I use the term experiment when our forefathers wrote our Declaration of Independence and our Constitution. They created a very unique form of government. They have three branches that should be co-equal branches. One is the executive, and that's obviously the president and our governors. The legislative, they're the ones that make the laws, and the judicial there to enforce the laws. The federal and state agencies, they've been created primarily since about the 1930s. This was part of the New Deal. This is what Roosevelt did as part of the New Deal, was creating these agencies and having agencies enforce the laws and start drafting regulations to do so. But what is our real governing class? One of the things that we always talk about, and people will comment on, is they'll talk about us being a democracy. We are not a democracy. We are a constitutional republic, and the significance of that is that we are a representative form of government. Our legislators represent us, and if they are not doing their jobs, they're not doing what we want, we have the ability to vote them out of office. The problem is, however, that when there is a different, when it is coming from the executive branch, when it is the executive agencies that are writing laws, which is what regulations are, they're not accountable to anybody. In fact, we have read repeatedly over the last 6 to 8 months, just looking at the VA as an example, that while there were several people that were fired in the VA because they are a union and they have collective bargaining agreements, the VA has actually had to hire people back that we know were falsifying documents and delaying health care for our veterans. And the VA has been forced to hire them back. These people are unaccountable to us, yet their sole purpose in life is supposed to be representing us and carrying out their jobs for the citizens of this country. So who is the real governing class? If you look in 2009, Congress passed 125 bills. There were over 3,500 regulations adopted by federal agencies in just that 1 year. Going down to 2013, Congress passed 72 new laws in 2013. There were over 3,659 new regulations in that 1 year. That's 51 regulations for every law and a new rule every 2.5 hours. 2016, highest number in the history of the United States. Congress passed 214 laws. There were 3,853 new regulations, a ratio of 18-1. So what you're seeing is that the real governing class are these regulatory agencies, not our elected representatives. So agencies don't answer to the voters. So the unelected end up doing the majority of the lawmaking. And I'm going to tell you, if it is a properly adopted regulation, if it goes through the process, it has the same force and effect of law as does any statute that is passed by Congress or by your state house. Our elected officials are allowed to avoid making difficult decisions. And I don't mean to be terribly critical of some of our elected officials. We have some very, very good ones. But what you're seeing, and I see this a lot at the congressional level, is I see people come home and they say, those darn agencies, those doggone agencies, my gosh, we've got to do something about the EPA. We've got to do something about the Department of Education. We've got to do something about the Department of Housing and Health and Human Resources. But what do? They're the ones that have the legal authority to rein them in. They can pass any statutes they want. They can do away with the regulatory agencies tomorrow if they chose to do so. What we have found in the business model that I have seen and what I have been watching happening is that Congress actually wants the agencies to act so that they don't have to, because then they don't have to be accountable. But agencies are then incentivized to expand their jurisdiction, their authority, their oversight, their involvement. Pretty soon you see a little agency that started out like this, and it becomes just this enormous behemoth that you can't hardly even rein in for any under any purpose. What does that mean? Job protection. No accountability. It is nearly impossible to fire federal employees. But here's something else that has become very troubling to me, and I only learned about it about maybe 8 years ago. I was over in Salt Lake City, and I was meeting with some folks who were looking at constructing a pipeline in order to provide water, and we had to work with the U.S. Bureau of Reclamation. We were in the office with the Bureau, and they said, this sounds like a great project. We're going to be your consulting agency. Yes, we want to work with you. Here, you need to sign this document. So they slid a piece of paper across the table to the project proponents. I was the attorney. That's all I am. But the folks that I represent were there. And we said, well, what is the piece of paper? And they said, you need to sign this piece of paper saying that you will fund the environmental impact statement. I thought, well, but under NEPA, it's the federal agency that does the environmental impact statement, not the project proponent. But I'm a person who believes in limited government, and I believe in fiscal responsibility, and I believe in conserving resources. So I thought, well, maybe it's okay that it is the agent or the project proponents that have to pay for an EIS. Then I started really thinking about it. If you do that, what is happening is that these agencies are using permitting to self-fund. All right, think about the incentive. Why do you think it takes 2 years to get a 404 permit? Why do you think it takes 5 or 6 years to get an EIS done? Because the entire time that we are working on that EIS, I'm hiring consultants. I'm hiring people like Bob. I'm hiring consultants who are doing my hydrologic analysis and my reclamation analysis and my restoration analysis and all of that. I'm hiring consultants, but I'm also paying the agency. I am paying the agency, I am paying their employees, I am paying their salaries, and I am making sure that they are not accountable to Congress, because it isn't that they're not going to Congress to get their money. So what are they doing? They're using permitting fees, they're using EIS, they're using 404 permitting requirements, and they are self-funding their agencies. I am going to tell you this is a horrific development, and it is one that needs to be addressed by Congress. We very seriously need to address this, because as long as we do this, gridlock and delay is going to be the order of the day, and we can't build roads. It has increased the cost of every single project out there, from roads to dams to irrigation projects to whatever it is, and it is really kind of a devastating thing. Then we talk about redundancy, and I'm going to tell you there's a lot of redundancy in all of these agencies. We have an EPA at the federal level. We have a Department of Environmental Quality at the state, Department of Transportation, Department of Education. You can go on and on and on and on and on, and you have a federal counterpart to a state counterpart. Why are we doing that? Why are we doubling up? Why in the world would we want to have a Department of Education in every state and one at the federal level? The same with the DOT. There are some interstate highways I recognize. I'm not suggesting we get rid of the DOT, but the DOT does not need to have the kind of authority it does when we have our own Department of Transportation. Same with Department of Agriculture. That one, there's very little that a federal Department of Agriculture ought to be doing. That is a state issue, and that ought to remain with the state. But it's also very costly and contradictory, and these are just some of the Clean Water Act, the Endangered Species Act, the National Forest Management Act, the management of state forest lands. What we're seeing is we're just seeing that all of these agencies are costing us money at all of these different levels of review. One of the other things that I think is quite troubling is when I go and meet with state agencies, and I get along pretty well with our DEQ, not the EPA. I fight with the EPA like cats and dogs. I do get along pretty well with our DEQ because I find them to be fairly reasonable. They try to work with somebody who has created a problem or been accused of creating a problem. Not the EPA. The EPA is pure punishment. Absolute, pure, unadulterated punishment. You do something the EPA can come after you for, they are going to put you in prison, and they are going to fine you for every dollar that they can get out of you. But at the state level, they're not like that. But now our state agencies, when I go in and talk to them and say, you know, we need to talk about moving a particular head gate. We need to talk about moving a point of diversion. We need to talk about doing, you know, something associated with, I don't even know what it might be, something to do with a confined animal feeding operation. And they say, well, we're going to have to get a hold of the Corps of Engineers. We're going to have to talk to the EPA. I'm like, no. You can't talk to the EPA. It has nothing to do with them. You have to make the decision. You're my agency. You represent me. You represent my clients. But they're starting to think of themselves as arms of the federal government. That's not a good thing. Finally, though, in 2011, President Obama issued an executive order on regulations. A government-wide review of the rules already on the books to remove outdated regulations that stifle job creation and make our economy less competitive. Great, I'm jumping up and down. We're gonna have some regulatory reform. I think this is actually very exciting. Let's see how we did. All right, as of 2011, pages of regulations published in the Federal Register, 82,419. The number of million hours of annual paperwork burden for that year, 119 million hours, and zero economically significant rules repealed. Not very successful. Let's look at 2012. In the first 27 days, we had an additional $7.7 billion of additional regulations put on the books, an additional 4,456 pages in the Federal Register, and 25.3 million hours of additional paperwork just in the regulations adopted in the first 27 days of that year. On June 22nd, we finally got a regulation repealed. Spilled milk is no longer considered an oil spill. That's it. That's it. That's how we did. Let's look at this. 2016, the Federal Register finished the year with a record high 95,894 pages, 19% higher than in 2015. But here's what happened. On November 9th, the regulatory agencies went into high